Hey, these are my thoughts on Norman Doidge's video on the brain that changes itself. I find it absolutely fascinating. Not that I'm anything special. Please understand that's not what I'm saying. But I was very blessed that when I was getting my master's degree, I was very much introduced to neuroscience and was taught neuroscience and related especially to motor skills as a physical therapist. One of my favorite patients to work with are people who've had strokes. So I want to relay some of this information, if I possibly can, to help you relate this to the DNRS. And the reason I'm doing this is because this is what convinced me DNRS works. Not this particular video in itself, but it was part of it, I would say, but because neuroplasticity works. And I had absolutely never thought about neuroplasticity in the realm of, say, my pops and its and my triggers and all that kind of stuff that was affecting me. And so once I started thinking about that, it just completely fit together. Okay, so in his video, first of all, you watch the lady with the balance issues, and she could no longer do anything because she couldn't handle the balance. Okay, so they put this like a reed in her mouth, and it began to create a different sensation that went to the brain that created a new neural pathway. And what they noticed is that the longer she practiced with this in her mouth, the more the residual effects, the more her balance got better. But what is so amazing about that is that eventually this practice led to the point where she didn't even need it anymore, and she was fine. That's the same thing with our DNRS. This is why we practice every single day. This is why we got to be committed to that, because that practice will eventually get us to the point we don't need the practice. Our brain has created the new healthy patterns, and it just does what it's supposed to do in a healthy limbic system. And then in the constraint-induced therapy, where they took the healthy hand and put a mitt on it and forced the patients to do something with their unhealthy hand. Okay, I've been a part of this type of therapy. I absolutely love working with people like this, because what I tell them is, first of all, you're not stuck. This limb may seem like it's not working, but it can work again. But we've got to work on it from your brain to that limb, which requires you making decisions that will force the work and use of this hand, because you're creating new pathways to connect your brain to this hand to do this work. Okay? I like what he said in there, the doctor that they're quoting. He said that the patients learned not to try to use, say, their hand or their leg, whatever it is, and it's not because they can't. They're not using this part of their body because they've learned not to use it. I've had a lot of patients that I would work with patients, particularly say right after they've had the stroke, within usually hours or days, right in the hospital type thing. And I'm one of the first people who's getting them up, standing up on their feet, making them push down and use that arm that's like just floppy. And I put pressure and I make them visualize and think about using that kind of thing. All right. But then often they've got a family member in the room who says, oh, well, I'll feed them. They say it's their right hand. They're right-handed. Well, they'll sit there and they'll feed them. They'll wipe their face for them. They'll clean their bottoms for them, whatever it is. Now, they are doing it completely out of love, but they're enabling that process of that patient learning not to use this hand. And so I will talk to them about use this hand. Do it. Okay, guys, it's the same thing with us. We cannot enable those broken patterns to keep working. We have to recognize this is a broken pattern. This neural pathway is not working right, and we have to make that decision to use it, just like these patients had to make that decision to use this hand that seems useless to them. We have to make that decision and do it, and we can, and it works. And I love what he talks about, the plasticity paradox. As we grow and develop, say from childhood, either we become very rigid or very changing, healthy individuals. We can develop very rigid patterns in life and behaviors and thought processes, or we can develop healthy things and change. I'm trying to fix this video just a second, sorry. And so what leads to the rigidity, he says, is the spontaneity, hold on, I have it in my notes just a second. Spontaneity, creativity, and unpredictability of childhood can lead to a routinized existence, means just, you know, like you're stuck in a rut. stuck in a rut. This is what Annie talks about us. Our brain is just stuck in a rut, right? Which repeats the very same behaviors over and over, right? Same thing with our brain. Same thing with this. We say, stop. We're stuck in a rut. We're recognizing we're stuck in a rut. And it turns it into very rigid characters of ourselves. So whether we all develop these limbic system issues when we are in a childhood, I would say that might be the case for more of us than we realize, that we've created a pattern. And especially, I think, with emotional patterns, but it can go with chemicals, it can go with mold exposure, it can go with whatever triggers you. And I'm not trying to just talk about that, but whatever it is, my point is, it can lead to the same behavior over and over. This is what Annie's trying to get us to see and understand. We've got stuck in a rut. Our brain is stuck in a rut, and we're repeating the same behaviors. And our job is to change the way we think and the way we behave and respond to these stimuli. The other part that puts us into a very rigid cells is very unvaried repetition. Like your work or your career, you do the same thing over and over and over and over and over. I think of someone standing in a toll booth, and I'm sorry if you do, I don't mean defense, any offense in any way, but you know, like somebody in a toll booth all day long may hand a receipt to someone. That's all they seem to do all day long. Car comes up, hand a receipt. Car comes up, you've got a repetitive job, do something different. Make it varied. Say different words to each person. Pick 10 different phrases. That's just my suggestions of what I'm thinking of. Cultural activity. Some of us, we're stuck in the same thing. Some of us go to church every Sunday and sit in the same exact seat because that's what we've done every week all of our lives. That's just what comes to mind. Anyways, just might think. Skills repeated. You have the same skill. You have a job or you have a screwdriver. And you use a screwdriver over and over and over. There's nothing stimulating to your brain making growth and positive changes. So think about that. What can you do to vary it? And then neurosis. I would say many of us in this group have affected some level of neurosis, which is just like death of the neurons and the cells as well. But the brain is changing all of the time. And then we go to the guy with the thinking exercises, and he talks about the piano and how they had some people sit down and just actually practice piano, a group of people just think about practicing the piano and just moving their fingers and going through that motion. And guess what? The parts of the brain's changed. His whole thing is our thoughts change. So what are we thinking about? This is why those pop opposites are there, to help us to change our thoughts, shift our thinking. Because you want to know that thinking turns on genes inside the neurons that form new connections between your brain cells. We want healthy new connections, which requires new healthy thoughts for many of us, and for many of us to take captive those thoughts that are not. And then they have brain scans that show that. And then quickly, the last guy about the phantom pain and the guy who had the amputation. I've worked with a lot of patients who have amputees and they have severe phantom pains, and like, it's just awful. And the more they think about it, the worse it actually gets, right? Because Annie taught us that the more we think about things, it strengthens it, right? So this doctor uses imagination and illusion to change the brain. That is so much of why we do future visualizations, and we imagine these things, and we create illusions that do that. He fights one illusion with another illusion. And so that's so big part of what we do in our DNRS practice daily, is we are doing illusions of our futures type things. And then also those of us who participate in laughter yoga, this is what laughter yoga does too. It fights one illusion with another, changes your thought patterns, gets it away from one thing and onto another kind of thing. And I also love, he talks about vision and motor input being so important, and how this vision and motor input for this guy with the amputated arm helped to relieve pain. Well, that's where we get into mirror neurons. He talks about mirror. That removes the barrier between you and me. So if I'm watching you do your rounds, it's helping me do rounds type thing. But if those of us who listen to like recorded rounds, close your eyes. I would suggest closing your eyes and thinking about imagining that is us. Imagining that is me. And getting all that visual input. And also, for me, also makes me want to do way more of my rounds in front of my mirror and watch me because I believe those neuroneurons are going to go back and forth. So anyways, this may have been a little bit long and a little bit complicated, but I hope that helped. I got pretty fired up. So you guys have a blessed day.